Hello and welcome to this episode of Onmanorama's special interview. Today, my guest is eminent historian, Professor Stephen Day. He joins me from the United States. Professor Day is an emeritus professor at the Department of History at the Ohio State University. He researched on the Mappila Muslims of Malabar in the 1970s. His book, Islamic Society on the South Asian Frontier, The Mappilas of Malabar, is a well-structured and clearly argued history of Mappilas spanning several centuries. Thank you so much, Professor Stephen Dale, for joining me on this interview.
It's my great pleasure.
So let me explain the context of this interview. Kerala has been witnessing a lot of discussions on Malabar rebellion in the last couple of weeks. The reason was that a prominent Malayalam filmmaker has decided to make a movie on the leader of this rebellion, Variyankunnath Kunyahammad Haji.
Oh, yes.
Professor Dale, let me start by asking you about the different narratives about the Malabar rebellion. Broadly, we have two different perspectives on the rebellion. First one is the colonial and Hindu right-wing perspective, and the second one is the nationalist and Marxist perspective. Colonial and right-wing narratives consider the rebellion as attacks carried out by Muslim fanatics against Hindu landlords. The nationalist and Marxist narrative portray the Malabar rebellion as a fight against imperialism. So what do you think about these narratives? Which one do you subscribe to?
The rebellion was a very complex and really unplanned phenomenon, stimulated by the Khilafat non-cooperation movement, but which triggered a number of sort of feelings among them. What many of the Mappilas did was immediately attack government institutions, that is to say, British institutions. So there was certainly a feeling, I would say the most obvious and immediate phenomenon of the Mappila rebellion was the attack on government institutions, government soldiers, for example, such as the attacks in Tirunelveli. Beyond that, of course, some of the individuals, some of the leaders, such as V.K. Haji, had a political ideal, I think. That is, a political ideal of establishing an Islamic government. In Valavanad and Ernad, some of the Taluks in Malabar. So it depends. It depends how you interpret this, but I think certainly the attacks on government institutions suggest that there was a widespread anti-British feeling. Now, certainly there is this tension, long-term tension, between the John Mee class and tenants in Malabar, which was not confined, of course, to the Mappilas, but the Mappilas had an ideology which justified their resistance to the John Mee class, and Hindu tenants did not. I think that's the big difference. I wouldn't absolutely subscribe to either of those things completely, because it was such a complex phenomenon, and many of the people who were involved interpreted it in different ways. I mean, there were some attacks on the John Mee class, but in B.K. Haji's case particularly, the ideology seemed to be very early on an anti-British ideology, which was stimulated by the Caliphate, and the goal of which was the establishment of some kind of Islamic government in those taluks.
33 Mappila outbreaks were recorded between 1836 and 1919. The most identifiable character of these outbreaks was the suicide of the people who took part in the attacks. As you mentioned, of the 350 Mappilas directly participated in the attacks, 322 died of suicide or martyrs. How do you view this ritualized form of suicides?
I think, of course, it's a part of this tradition which goes all the way back to the Portuguese period. And one of the things I was struck by when I was in Malabar area in the 1970s, which I also have a photograph of in the book, there's an offering box, I can't remember what road it's on now, to the Badr Shahadakal Nirchapati, the offering box to the martyrs of the Battle of Badr, which is after all a battle in Arabia in the 7th century. This tradition of Islamic martyrdom, in especially in the Malabar area, not solely, but mainly in the Malabar area, because that's where the spice trade is concentrated.
Yeah,
goes all the way back to the 16th, all the way back to the 16th century. And you can see examples of it in the 16th century, 17th century, 18th century, 19th century. So that's one thing. I think the other aspect of it is, of course, once the British had established fairly firm control in Malabar district, when the Mappilas took action, or when they challenged or even attacked members of the Janmi class, who were usually Rambudras or Nairs, they knew that they would be captured. When the Mappilas attacked or even murdered a Janmi, they knew that they would be captured and probably executed.
Yeah.
Certainly imprisoned and probably executed, I think. And so I think for many of them, the alternative was to die as a martyr, that is to die as a respectable man within the context of the Islamic community.
Okay. As we mentioned about the suicides, we could see these kind of suicides happening in other parts of Asia, like in Aceh, in Indonesia, and Philippines.
Yes.
So is it possible to establish any kind of connection between these suicides?
Of course, there's the one phenomenon that all those suicides in Aceh and in Indonesia or in Sumatra and in the Philippines were reactions against the Europeans.
Yep.
That's one thing. There were Muslims who went back and forth between these areas. Particularly, there was one settlement on the, not too far from Baipur, as I remember, in which the members of the Mappa community had connections with Indonesia. I was told that some of the pamphlets, some of the little books that were written about the incidents in, or about the ideology of the Mappilas, were also carried by Muslims to Indonesia. I'm not sure about the Philippines, but certainly to Indonesia. So there was a definite connection between Muslim, certainly the Muslim merchants in Kerala and the Muslim merchants in Indonesia. There was a very close connection. I talked to one of the descendants of, as you probably know, the Mamluk Tongil when I was there in 1977, and he showed me many of the Muslims who were traders were from this Hadhami side community. That is to say, from these Muslims who came from the Yemen, the Hadhramaut in Yemen. And many of these families were connected all the way from East Africa to Kerala to Indonesia, and perhaps the Philippines too. I know much less about the Philippines than Indonesia, but it's quite possible that there was also a personal connection. There was certainly definitely a personal connection between Kerala or the Muslims in Kerala and Indonesia, absolutely. But I think the main reason for those outbreaks was the sort of assault of the Europeans on the Muslim trading communities there in those areas.
Professor, there are some attempts to portray this Mappila suicides as jihad or holy war. How do you view such readings?
That's really a mistake, and I think. Except, I mean, I suppose you could say that with V.K. Haji and his interest in establishing a Muslim state, you might possibly interpret it that way. But the Mappila rebellion did not really have the characteristic of it. In my mind, it did not have really the characteristic of a jihad. There was not really an attempt, for example, to forcibly to convert members of the Hindu community.
Yeah.
I think there may have been one or two cases, but there was no kind of central direction, not conducted like the kind of jihad that you hear about maybe now, or you heard about in earlier history, I think, because you simply don't see that kind of religious enthusiasm for converting the non-Muslims, whether they're Hindus or Christians. And you can see that in other situations, in other countries and so forth, but not in this case, I think, at all, really. And again, going back to what happened in the outbreak of the rebellion, the attacks were directed at government facilities, at, at British troops, at British officers, and government facilities. But they weren't, as far as I know, there weren't any attacks directed at, particularly at Christians, individual Christians, although there may have been a small number in that area. And as I say, I don't believe there was any systematic attempt or attack or attempt to forcibly convert the members of the Hindu community. So in that sense, I think you can't really view it as a jihad, even though you have a kind of religious ideology, but the ideology was more of a political one in establishing political control than as a religious, as a kind of religious movement, I think.
So everybody is terming this Malabar rebellion as Mappila rebellion. However, only one third of the Muslims from the three South Malabar taluks participated. Mm-hmm. Rich Muslims did not endorse it. Salafi right. movements did not support it. It was not mm-hmm. a pan-Islamist movement. But it also saw participation from Hindus. Then how the name Mappila Rebellion got acceptance in the society?
I think because most of the people who did take part were Mappilas. They were poorer Mappilas. But I think that the majority of the ones who engaged in violence, I think, were Mappilas, I believe. And I think that's the reason. Of course, it's also easier. This is also talking about how the British interpreted this, I think, because the British tended to be quite paranoid about Muslim political activity after the mutiny, and some of the events in Bengal in the 19th century. So I think the British tended to emphasize these things in that way, especially if Muslims are involved. But I think probably it's legitimate to call it the Mappila Rebellion in the sense that, except for a very few Hindus who are involved because of the Khilafat non-cooperation movement, I think, most of the people who are involved in the violent activities or actually the fighting with the British troops were in fact Mappilas. I don't think it's a mistake to say that.
Those outrages and the Malabar rebellion confined to the three taluks of South Malabar, especially
when
the North Malabar has a huge number of Mappila population. What is the reason?
Yes, it does. Yes, right. That's the most difficult question to. That is really a difficult question to answer. I thought about that a great deal when I was studying this. I think it had to do with the individual leadership, and as you say, even in the 19th century, there were cases of outbreaks directed at Janmis in which some of the tenants of the Janmis refused to participate. I mean, I think it had to do primarily, I think, with the leadership. That is, say, where was VK Haji from? And then of course the Turungadi is a particularly important situation because Turungadi had a long history of conflict with the Europeans going all the way back to the Portuguese. So, and you're quite right that most of the more well-to-do Mappilas didn't participate at all, and Calicut was not even touched. So it seems to me that It's a very good question.
Basically, the Malabar rebellion appears to have been largely ignored. For example, officially, 2,337 people were killed, 1,652 persons were wounded, and 45,000 people were imprisoned. Unofficially, the death count was 10,000. However, it did not get importance like the Jallianwalabagh massacre of 1919, in which 379 people killed, or Chauri Chaura incident, in which 23 policemen were burnt alive by angry peasants. Why didn't Malabar rebellion get enough national attention?
Perhaps part of the reason is that the Khilafat non-cooperation movement itself was a nonviolent movement, and many of the people were appalled by what had happened in Malabar, I think. I would suspect that the immediate reason was that the Khilafat non-cooperation leaders did not want to publicize such things. Okay. That's one possibility. The British themselves probably did not want to publicize this.
The movement, the Mappila rebellion or Malabar rebellion, mm-hmm. was confined to areas within the Mappila majority. And why it did not happen in the Hindu majority areas?
One of the striking things, of course, in the 19th century is there were many more Hindu tenants who were affected by the Janmi class than Muslim tenants were affected, but they never rebelled. They never went into rebellion against them. And of course, the reason in this case really has to do with ideology. And I suspect that most of the Hindus, like the more well-to-do Mappilas, were terrified of what was happening, probably. My impression is that's my impression. But I don't think that the Mappila rebellion continued because the Mappilas were angry at the Hindus. I don't think that's the case at all, really. Okay. No doubt there's this tension between poor Mappila tenants and the Janmi class. I mean, there's that tension existed, but just thinking about it now, talking with you, it seems to me that you couldn't interpret what had happened as an outbreak which was directed against the Hindus because they didn't support this protest. I think that's not true at all, really.
Okay.
I mean, I can't think of anything that really would really support that idea.
Okay, cool. So thank you so much, Professor Dale, for this fascinating interview. I'm deeply grateful to you.
Thank you. It's a wonderful to talk to you.